Hi, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. On today's show, we're going to have Jesse Bethke Gomez. He's Executive Director of the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living, and he has just returned from the White House doing some national work on PCA care. He'll be coming up. And covering our legislative update today will be Trevor Turner from the Minnesota Council on Disabilities. And so we'll hope you'll stay tuned and watch us next on Disability Viewpoints. Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. I'm Mark Hughes. With me today is Trevor Turner from the Minnesota Council on Disabilities, and I'd like to make an invite to everybody to come on down to the MnDOT cafeteria Wednesdays. We do Community Wednesday down there. I believe it's about 10 o'clock in the morning, and everybody is welcome, and Trevor's going to do our legislative update today. Trevor, welcome to the show, and what's on the legislative update today?
Thank you, Mark. We have a very busy session. The legislature actually met first deadline last Friday, which is March 10th. And the first deadline is where a bill has to be heard in either the House or the Senate, in one of the committees in either the House or the Senate. And so the last week or so was a rush to get as many of those bills heard as possible to meet that first deadline. So now we're actually in the second deadline period of the session. So, and on March 24th, we have our second deadline coming up, which means that all bills must have been heard in both the House and the Senate in order to be considered for passage into law. And so that is what the really is motivating the legislature right now, is getting as many of those bills heard as possible. So this week, you're going to see a lot of bills that have already been heard in either the House or the Senate, and now they're going to be heard in the opposite body. And that is what's going to be driving the next couple of weeks until the second deadline approaches on March 24th. This legislative session has been extremely positive for disability-related legislation. I would say that it's probably a record number of disability bills have been introduced this year. We have probably several hundred bills, which you can actually see on the Minnesota Council on Disabilities website. We have a disability bill tracker, so you can see all the bills that have been introduced so far and click on them and learn more about them. But the sheer number of disability bills that have been introduced and heard in committees has been unprecedented. And so we're really busy at the Minnesota Council on Disability because of the amount of bills being heard.
Yeah, and wasn't disability parking one of them that went in the Senate not too long ago?
Yeah, we had quite a disability parking related bills. You know, the Council on Disability has a bill that it would eliminate the 24-hour grace period that is currently given to businesses for blocking disability parking. We believe that that statute predates the Americans with Disabilities Act and makes enforcing disability parking almost impossible for our law enforcement. And so by getting rid of this 24-hour grace period, it allows law enforcement to go just once and cite the offending business or for blocking disability parking. And that had a hearing in the Senate Transportation Committee a couple weeks ago.
You know, there's a lot of disability parking that's done by state law. Are there federal statutes in it too?
Can you repeat that question again?
There's a lot of disability parking that's done by law under state statute. Are they figured in the federal statutes too? I think there is some federal mandates they have to follow there.
Yes, I mean the ADA, the Americans with Disabilities Act itself, right, mandate disability parking in itself. So yes, there are federal laws as well.
And what else has the Minnesota Council on Disability been working on?
Well, we've been following the legislature and everything that's going on, especially when it comes around the budget surplus. So last week, the Office of Management and Budget released their budget forecast for February, last month, released their budget forecast, and they this time they actually adjusted for inflation. So prior to this legislative session, it was actually
they have not been.
they had not been adjusting the budget surplus for inflation. Mm-hmm. It was actually against the law to do that. So the legislature this year passed a law repealing that, and the governor signed it. And so now the February forecast includes inflationary considerations. And even with the inflationary consideration, it's still $17.5 billion, which is basically, it remained basically the same.
So with that new law, do you consider that as a Minnesota council a good thing that they adjust for inflation on there now?
It wasn't a priority for us, but it does have impact on the legislature and how everything gets spent, especially because so much of human services, for example, is one of the larger spending committees, and they this budget surplus will determine how much money. So this that each committee gets to spend on the budget surplus. And so we'll actually be hearing that in the next week or so. We'll be hearing what the targets are. Targets are just what the amount of the surplus can be spent by each committee. Wow. And so that will really determine which bills ultimately get passed into law, because it'll because they'll know exactly how much money they can spend. And if the bill is too expensive, it won't pass.
Well, I served 12 years on the Minnesota Council on Disability myself, so I wish you the best on that. Before we go, is there anything that I might have missed that we haven't covered, anything you want to say before we go?
Yeah, so like I said, continue to follow the bill tracking we have on the Minnesota Council on Disabilities website. We have heard so many bills. I'll be releasing an update on which bills, disability-related bills, have met the first deadline, probably the next week or so, so you can learn more about what bills actually have a chance of passing this session.
One more question for you, and this is a burning question. Have there been any surprises for you for you thus far that have gone on down there, be they good or bad? Something you thought might have passed or didn't pass? Any surprises?
I would say a lot of positive surprises. Just simply the number of bills that have been introduced, bills that are getting hearing within days of being introduced. That last session took me months to get a hearing for, or was really hard to get a hearing at all.
Yeah.
And so the willingness of the legislature this year to hear disability-related legislation has been a really pleasant surprise, for sure.
All right, and we'll see you. You and I have our own bills, so we'll be working on that. So we'll see you in the Senate real soon. Thanks for being on here, Trevor. Great report. We'll talk to you. Trevor Turner from the Minnesota Council on Disabilities. Jesse Bethke Gomez from the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living is next. He's got a recent visit he had in Washington, D.C. He'll tell us all about it next on Disability Viewpoints. Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints, now in our 25th year. We have the good honor today of having Jesse Bethke Gomez, Executive Director of the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living. He's got really big news. Jesse, welcome to the show. You've been at Metropolitan Center for Independent Living 8 years. I read your information the end of last week, like Friday, and you have just recently returned from the White House. So if you want to do your overview of the Metropolitan Center Independent Living first and work up to your trip to Washington, D.C., let us know you're working on. The show is yours. Take it away.
Well, my goodness. It's an honor to be here with you on Disability Viewpoints.
Thanks for being here.
And it's an honor to serve as the Executive Director for our Metropolitan Center for Independent Living. Our agency began in 1981. It is actually what's called a statutory nonprofit, by way of Minnesota Statute 268A-01, Subdivision 8, Centers for Independent Living.
You've got that down. Great.
We're also, originally was part of the Rehabilitation Act of 1973, and that changed over to the Workforce Innovations and Opportunity Act on November 16, 2018. So as a Center for Independent Living, we provide assistance and services to people with disabilities, with apparent and non-apparent disabilities in the 7-county metro area. I'm always pleased and honored to share with folks that there are 8 centers for independent living who, for the most part, address the needs of people with disabilities in all of the 87 counties throughout the state, and there are 405 centers for independent living located throughout the United States. And federally, the Centers for Independent Living report to or work with the Administration for Community Living.
Great.
And that is led by Commissioner Jill Jacobs, who was appointed by Honorable President Joe Biden in, I understand, September of 2021.
Great.
So that's a little bit about who we are as an agency.
I have one question for you. How did the changes affect you from becoming in 1973 to the new change in 2018? What change did that affect the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living?
You know, it's a really great point. The centers are codified in the Federal Register, Federal Register 366. So when they change from one law to the other, the codification of our requirements remained exactly the same. So that no great changeover. If anything, it was nice to see that with the importance of the Workforce Investment and Opportunity Act, that the centers continue to be a critically important means and voice of for services by people with disabilities, for people with disabilities. 50% of our employees must be people with disabilities. Over 50% of our board must be people with disabilities. What I'd like to share with you is that though I am not a person with disabilities, my family members have had lifelong disabilities, and God bless my parents, before they passed, they were persons with disabilities. And for me, we always grow up with the idea of to be all you can be, which really is the full realization of what independent living is all about anyway.
Right.
So for me, being at MCIL, frankly, it's just like being at home.
Yeah. Well, it seems like, by the way, you're doing this interview, it's been great. But Metropolitan Center for Independent Living is not just independent living. It leads to employment, and you have other services too. You're a big operation. The name Metropolitan Center for Independent Living is not just that, because it's a bigger operation than it portrays to be.
It is. We have our independent living, our core services as the Center for Independent Living, helping people with fully realizing independent living. We work closely with the Vocational Rehabilitation Services in the state of Minnesota on benefits coaching. We assist over 13 voc rehab locations in the metro area. We also have case management services in Hennepin County and Ramsey County. We also have our home-based services, which is our choice PCA program. We provide for people who rely upon PCAs for daily living. We also, I'm proud to say, have ADA Minnesota. Every year, ADA Minnesota celebrates that, and of course, Cindy Tarshish is
great people. She's another phenomenal person. And then we have Nick Wilkie, who co-anchors this show every once in a while with the Minnesota Center.
We're proud of Nick. And then
so thanks for sharing him with us.
Yeah, absolutely. We're happy to do so. And then we're also one of two operation centers for Disability Hub MN. We've been that for many years. But our agency, early on in 2016, we were asked to attend the meetings hosted by the Minnesota Department of Human Services on the growing concern for the direct care crisis and the growing concern on the gap between PCAs to assist people in the PCA program and the growing gap of jobs that are not filled. And so what happened then, I was asked, along with our board chair, Jeff Bangsberg, to join a cross-work agency committee that was requested by Minnesota's what's called the Olmsted Sub-Cabinet. And we worked on from the end of 2016 throughout all of 2017 on a report. And then the final report, myself and two other technical writers drafted seven major recommendations to address and to solve the direct care crisis facing the state of Minnesota.
Right.
And I'm pleased to share with your audience that was approved by the Minnesota's Olmsted Subcabinet in March of 2018. And really, it was that initial work. We were funded by the Bush Foundation for a community innovation grant to help solve the PCA workforce shortage. And ever since 2018, in addition to all of the services that we've been a part of, we have joined many others in the solution, right, and many have joined us to bring about the kind of changes that need to happen. And it was in that work that we were recommended to attend the meeting at the White House.
Yeah, that's the next big announcement. But I do want to say that before COVID struck the state pretty hard, that the SEIU union was getting formed and going on PCA issues down there. And it has always been a problem with PCAs. I hope that a lot of these new organizations can help out, and I hope the work that we get from Washington, D.C., and you've just returned, can help out alleviate some of this issue, because it's a big issue. And one of the things that I've recommended is the PCA care as far as the hourly wage. The more education you have in PCA care, the more you make an hour on a tiered education basis. Now, I don't know how far that's going to go, but I have brought that under recommendation, and not because I thought of it. I think there's other people that have thought of that too. But I do want to hear more now at this time about your trip to the White House. That's exciting.
Well, you know, we were among 50 people invited to the White House, and over a day, we met on March 1st at the White House. We actually met in what's called the Eisenhower Office Building, which was fun to go to the White House. And just to give you kind of the set the stage here, I have been to the White House before. I was invited by the administration of President Barack Obama. And so it had been probably about 10 years since I've been to the White House. What I was struck by was that, you know, going to the White House, and hopefully we're seeing the tail end of this pandemic, but I was really struck by the impact of the pandemic. This was one of the reasons why we went to the White House, to look at the impact that President Biden has made in Minnesota. And during that pandemic, if we all remember, it was in March of 2020, we had our own executive order, and throughout the United States, we had to shut down our nation due to this pandemic. I am a Kellogg Fellow in public health from the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, which is the number one public health school in the country, along with their business school. And my training was on leadership in times of pandemics and leadership in times of community crisis. And my goodness, if there was ever a preparation, because the role of Metropolitan Center for Independent Living to play a role with so many others to assure that we could help advance accessible COVID testing, to make certain that we had accessible vaccinations, and to make certain that we were looking to assure that we could do everything we could to make certain that people with disabilities could get those vaccinations when they did.
Right.
And we're really pleased about our current work with the state of Minnesota Department of Health, notably on that work. But I was glad that you mentioned the pandemic, because that really was one of the reasons. What I wanted to share with you is that over $7.7 billion has provided to Minnesota during this time with the impact of the American Rescue Plan. And that was a large part of the meeting, was looking at ideas. They were very welcoming of ideas. And yes, we brought them ideas that we gave to the White House, notably to help solve the direct care workforce plan. But it really does start with a tremendous sense of appreciation and gratitude, because over 105 million people have been infected with COVID since the pandemic started. Well over a million people have lost their lives. Mm-hmm. And we know that people with disabilities and older adults have had higher COVID rates of infections. There have been a higher, if you will, death rate for people.
And so remember, it can be reoccurring. You can get it more than once.
You can. And so we also work closely with the Department of Health. I'm proud of Minnesota's Department of Health on their long COVID study, which is among the few in the nation, if not the only state in the nation, that is looking at a long COVID study. So I was happy to be a connector between what we're doing. They have their own, you know, way of connecting with folks in national, but I'm very proud of Minnesota, because of the work that we know that people with long COVID, and this is also understanding to be a disability as well.
Right.
So we're not out of the woods yet, but the point is that there's vigilance. There has been a great toil that we have played, and I'm very proud of how from schools to nonprofits to cities, okay, the state of Minnesota, our fine governor, our fine legislature have worked very closely with President O'Biden to make certain that all of the research that could be brought to bear have been brought to bear for all people with regard to COVID.
Well, two things also that the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living has shown some real leadership in these projects. Also, I want to take this time to let people know that Steve Groves has moved on as head of deed and is now going to run the Star Tribune. So we have some new leadership come in, and I think Jan Malcolm has stepped down as part of Department of Health, too, and she used to run Courage Center at one time. So we've had a good mix of people, and we've got some new talent coming in, and Metropolitan Center is leading the way again. Are you going to be invited back to the White House, you think, or are these going to be ongoing meetings?
Well, our hope is to help elevate the great concerns we have for people with disabilities and older adults with the way forward to strengthen direct care services and benefits. Mm-hmm. And if you'll allow me to give you one example.
Sure.
What we learned in the pandemic is for certain federal services, certain federal benefits, certain state benefits have what is called asset limitations.
Right.
You can have only so much assets. And we learned through the pandemic that certain services have a $2,000 asset limit, such as for many of our waiver services in Minnesota, which augments against some of the federal programs, and $3,000 for couples. Now, most people do not know this, that asset limitation was first promulgated in the federal government in 1983.
Right.
That means that's a $2,000 asset limit that has never changed for 40 years.
Right. And it needs to be updated. That was just my thought, exactly.
Well, that was part of what we delivered to the White House, was to say, based on the fundamental principles of who we are as a democracy, number one, certain inalienable rights of the pursuit of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. But number two, what I am convinced is that this second principle of democracy helped reorder and redefine our commitment to people who rely on direct care services to live the fullness of those uncertain inalienable rights,
right,
to live with certain inalienable rights, and it is this. It's about human dignity. It is self-evident that human dignity is equally endowed in all humanity.
Right.
That means every person throughout the world and throughout all time. And when we take the lens of human dignity and look at a 40-year asset limitation, the question is really not about the asset limitation, but the question is, who do we believe we are and who do we say we are, number one, as a democracy, and number two, as a civil society? Because I believe this: when we advance the ability of people to have appreciation for one another, when we advance the ability of people to care for one another, that is the most noble of all the values as a civil society, and it's what is needed right now, is to help elevate the conversation. The pandemic revealed that the direct care services and benefits are in great need of support,
yep,
and great,
yep,
need of helping to be elevated. And MCIL is working very, we're working hard at work. I don't know how else to say
you're,
it, but to bring
you
that,
know, you've hit the nail right on the head, and you're exactly right. I can tell you a couple things. Jeff Bangsberg and I, way back when, started for Jim Ramstead and started the ticket. He started the Ticket to Work program. This very program was done in Washington, D.C. for a lot of years under Jim Ramstead. So I did a lot of traveling at one time. And now Jeff Bangsberg is your chair, and how proud I am to know Jeff and the work that you're doing. And I want to thank you at this time, Jesse, for being on the show. And any final thought you want to say in about 30 seconds?
Happy to do so. There's much work to do, and that work really means, how do we affect change and make certain people are actively involved in understanding the changes that are there, and how to make certain that when we think about the services, direct care services, that they're guided by the civil rights, that they're guided by ADA, and that they're guided by what is in the best interest to make certain that, in my view, this is not an issue of resources. Really, this is an opportunity for us to fully realize our commitment to one another as a democracy. And what better way, I understand that as COVID is going to end in terms of the emergency declaration on May 11th, 2023, that we recommit ourselves to finding solutions in Minnesota that have an impact. Lastly, let me say that in our work with the state of Minnesota, notably the Department of Human Services, is really developing all of the tenets, all of the components with our added contributions of MCIL to not only solve this in the state of Minnesota, but we believe they are scalable throughout the country for over 4 million PCAs. So that work, I want to acknowledge the state of Minnesota, the SCI Union, PCAs, PC agencies, and most importantly, people who rely on PCAs who have been our guiding light in the work ahead. And I'm really grateful to you for allowing us to share that with you.
Anytime. You're always invited. And thanks for being on the show, Jesse. I'd love to have you on anytime.
Sounds good.
Okay,
thank you, sir.
Jesse Bethke Gomez, who's just returned from the White House and is Executive Director of the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living. Thank you very much.
My honor. Thank you, sir.
At this time, we'd like to thank Trevor Turner for doing our legislative update today. Did a great job. He's been very busy down in the political circles, such as the State Office Building and Capitol. We want to thank him for his work and hope he'll join us again for the legislative update. Jesse Bethke Gomez, Executive Director of the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living, and his great trip to the White House. It was very informative information. And I want to remember Judy Heumann, who is a national acclaimed disabled person that has really reimagined of what it's like to be disabled. And I want to do honor her passing right at this time. We will miss her very much. Thanks for watching Disability Viewpoints. I'm Mark Hughes. We'll see you soon. Bye for now.